Jack Kirby doesn't have a place in comic book history. He kind of is comic book history.
If you're wanting to paint, you look at the masters. If you want to do comic books, you look at the masters. And, you know, Jack Kirby is the master when it comes to comic books.
You really have to scratch really hard to find a truly creative person to put up against Jack Kirby. There really aren't that many.
I realized that he was creating a whole specific art style to himself, that he was this great exception to the rules that seem to be on most every other comic art.
If I had never met Jack Kirby, I probably would have done that sleepwalking stuff that everybody else did.
Nobody had ever drawn comics that had quite that much kapow in them.
I would buy comic books according to whether or not Jack Kirby drew them.
Nobody could draw that figure. Nobody.
He had no barriers. I mean, I had corners in my rooms. He didn't have corners in his rooms. His rooms were panoramas.
The shapes are so, oh God, I can't even look at it.
There's so much power. I mean, there's images that I can't ever get out of my head.
He's one of the absolute major titans to do American comic books.
Even when he was doing primitive stuff, he was getting dynamics. He was getting stretch. When he started to hit his prime in the FF, there was mass.
You know, he could make just the simple act of one guy hitting another guy in the face look like, you know, a cosmic calamity.
That's Jack Kirby's action, not violence, action. Big difference. Nowadays it's violence. When Jack did it, it was action.
And he invented all this stuff that people just used years, decades afterwards.
And it changed comics. It changed the industry. It certainly changed Marvel. And then Marvel changed the industry.
In those days, they were drawing 5 pages a day. I mean, you can't find people that can draw 5 pages a week.
So, I mean, he was a genius.
Yeah.
He was just a natural, brilliant talent.
I mean, here was a guy, he was designing architecture, he was designing planes, he was designing science fiction equipment, and it all looked like it would work.
You could draw like Jack, but you couldn't think like Jack. Very few people in the world ever could think like Jack.
When you throw enough shit at the wall, some of it's gonna stick, right? And the amazing thing is how much of his shit stuck.
In a way, he is somewhat the messiah of comic artists.
He said, "I'm a cartoonist," and he was very proud of that.
Jack Kirby is the king of comics. Jack Kirby did everything. It was just an amazing thing. You just kind of sit back and watch him. Just one thing after another, he's coming up with one hero, one idea, one concept after another.
What he did to the art form, as well as what he represented as a person, is it's a level you're given to measure up to, as well as almost an impossible challenge.
When I was a young artist, aspiring artist, I didn't like Jack Kirby's work at all.
It was like a love-hate thing, because on one hand, I didn't really like it, at least I didn't think I did, but I kept going back to it and I kept looking at it.
I avoided reading Jack's because it looked too blocky. Every time I saw a cover, I thought, just blocky, it's not very good.
Everything real chunky and it doesn't look very realistic. And as a kid, I was like, this guy can't draw. You know, this is ugly stuff.
Well, I would look at Kirby and I'd see these weird black wiggles and stuff and blocky, chunky figures. I'm like, what's up with that?
Artists aren't necessarily drawn to the cruder, tougher stuff. It took an education for me to like Jack Kirby.
Well, all I can say is I'm smarter than all those other guys you talked to because I liked it from the get-go.
I had an immediate positive reaction to Jack's work. It certainly was kind of off-kilter with what I understood is your basic bare-bones superhero comics, like the art styles I would recognize, like Neil Adams or John Romita Sr. But Jack's work I always found graphically appealing.
You know, I keep looking back at my Kirby comics going, well, that still looks weird, but it doesn't look as weird as I remember.
And then I started going backwards, finding the other things he'd done, and just got hooked on the New Gods and the Fourth World stuff. And from there, I went backwards to see what was all this hubbub about the 60s and Marvel and Fantastic Four. And then I discovered that stuff. It just totally, totally blew my mind.
And then it got to the point, I said, you know what, maybe I'll try incorporating some of this stuff into my work. And this is before I was a professional. It's like, and then you realize, wait, you know that black squiggly line? That's his kneecap. I had no idea that was his kneecap. And you realize that he was abstracting it all. And then you start realizing these chunky shapes, the power that he would put in the figure. And then you look at it again and you go, wow, this feels 3D to me.
I would buy comic books according to whether or not Jack Kirby drew them. And you just look, you know, and somebody gets you a comic book and says, no, that's Gene Colan. He's okay, but I don't want that. I don't want Gene Colan's Iron Man. I want Jack Kirby's Iron Man. I would get so upset when you'd see like three or four people, you know, Don Heck and Gene Colan, Jack Kirby all drawing a comic book. And you go, no.
Jack Kirby is more of a visceral artist. He works from the gut. He's it's powerful and dynamic and in some ways off-putting, because it makes you step back a little bit and wonder what the hell's going on here. And I was interested in drawing, I was interested in anatomy, I was interested in perspective and all these things that a young artist is interested in, and not interested in somebody who had taken all that stuff, put it in his back pocket, and then gone on to create just total action on a page.
So I didn't really like the stories by Jack Kirby because they were monsters. And then one day, and this happened, because I got this thing secondhand or something, you know, it wasn't like new on the stands. I was in art school, or just entered art school. I was beginning to see a whole new world of comprehension and perception opening before me. And then I came across The Double Life of Private Strong. And everything inside was beautiful. It was a real class A comic book. It looked like a comic book. It was colored like a comic book. It was quite well colored for once, you know? On the cover was this film strip of this character running away from me, or running sort of sideways or something like that, leaping, dropping, rolling, getting up and running again. This was one of the most remarkable pieces of comic book art I'd ever seen at that time. And it was so fluid, so beautiful, so easily done. I'm probably remembering it far better than it was, you know how things go. But it impressed me deeply, profoundly, I would say profoundly.
It's hard to separate Jack Kirby from the very core of comics, of comic books. There was a comic industry in the newspapers, and there was Hal Foster doing Tarzan and Prince Valiant and Flash Gordon by Alex Raymond, and Kniff doing Terry and the Pirates, and these were all wonderful storytelling tricks. But a whole different kind of approach had to be done in a comic book, because it was a finite story, trying to compact the story in 64 pages, but the 64 pages generally were more than one feature. So the comic book had to be a different identity.
He knew that for what he wanted to do, he had to develop his own style, because he had to work so fast. That was the other thing. He was in a medium that required, you know, a book a week, maybe sometimes two books a week. Who knows, you know, depending on the company. And especially in the 40s, when they were really turning that stuff out.
You know, people used to always say how fast Jack was, and they used to marvel at that. And Jack was very fast. But his amazing lifetime output was at least as much a product of his being willing to sit at the drawing board all day and all night.
You know, they got page rates. Depending on the amount of work you turned out, that's how much money you made.
He would go to the drawing table around noon every day, and he would just sit there until about 4 the next morning and just draw, and he didn't take vacations, and he didn't take days off.
You know, my father worked a lot, so he was basically a workaholic.
You know, you work to make a living, you work to support your family, and the fact that he was an artist doing that really didn't make a difference.
Because he had such a poor background. I grew in the projects of the Lower East Side. They had nothing. He lived in a tenement, and his parents were immigrants from Austria, and I think for him it was just really important that we were not going to live that way.
Jack was born on August 28th, 1917, in the part of New York where you had to use your fist to defend yourself if you were short.
It was very rough. It was just like he always used to say that he'd portrayed his childhood just like the R Gang comedies that were on TV, just exactly like that. They had their street gangs. But their street gangs were very kind of ethnic, you know, the Jewish guys in one block and the Irish guys and the Italian guys. And they'd get into their fist fights and whatnot, but that was it, you know, not quite what it's like today. So it was kind of a rough upbringing. But his, you know, his parents, he had a very close family, and primarily Orthodox Jewish on the Lower East Side. And they were, you know, very close, very loving, and, you know, he always helped to try to take care of the family, take care of his mother especially.
They lived in this tenement, and the tenements had these long hallways that were very dark. And Jack got a hold of some charcoal or something, and I guess was about 8 years old, and he just drew on that whole wall, just some outer space fantasy that he had.
And, you know, the landlord went up to his mom and, you know, Jackie's in trouble again, and did you see what he did? And she went out there and looked, and of course was like, oh, I can't believe he did this. But what he did to her was like, wow, I can't believe my kid did this. This kind of thing.
It was such a powerful drive that he had that he just, you know, he had to do it.
So I think he was always doing that. He read, as he got older, he read quite a bit, science fiction, he loved movies. And I think a lot of it and a lot of his art and his storytelling at a young age probably helped him escape from his harsh environment that he lived in.
So it was whatever he knew about drawing, it was from observation and just practice. I mean, he had that talent. I mean, there's no mistaking that, because if you look at the work that he did as a teenager and as a kid, it's, you know, it's advanced.
He tried going to the Pratt Institute of Art, and I think that lasted, it was a very short time, and then basically the Depression hit and his father was out of work, and so he started doing street signs for vendors and the vending carts and store windows to help his family make a living. So he never had, as far as I know anyway, never had any real formal training. Just with those artists that came before him and copying their styles.
He had a few pen names, I believe, when he first started. You know, he was born Jacob Kurtzberg, and which was probably a little bit too long at the time, and maybe a little too ethnic for the times as well. So I think he was like Lance Kirby for a while. There was a few other ones.
He did one strip as Jack Curtis. He did one strip as Bob Brown. He did one strip as Ted Gray. And there was one strip that was signed Kirby and one strip that was signed Jack. And at some point, different permutations of the names Jack and Kirby came together.
He did use Kirby quite a bit, and I think that's when he decided to go ahead and just change it legally.
Jack's first professional job really was working for Max Fleischer Studios. He started as a cell painter and a cell washer, and eventually he worked up to being an in-betweener.
So he had the main animators doing, you know, the main sets, and then these, you know, little hired hands, the in-betweeners, would just fill in all the, you know, 100 cells in between doing the action.
Which he didn't do for very long. It was a factory mentality job, sitting at long rows of desks, and he didn't really like that. It was not a creative job for him.
From there, I think actually he did some newspaper strips for some syndicated stuff before he actually got into comic books.
Jack went to work for a man named Victor Fox, who was very colorful in the comic book business as an entrepreneur and an exploiter of young talent.
He would tell us sometimes, he would laugh and talk about how guys working for Victor Fox in the 40s, if you wanted to cheat, you'd take a panel and you draw a little airplane in it and then put a big word balloon and said, wow, the guy in the plane, he said, move on. There were, you know, all kinds of tricks for getting around it, but he wouldn't do that, especially at his peak. I mean, he would just pour that stuff on.
The editor-in-chief at Victor Fox's company was a man named Mr. Roberts. There really was no Mr. Roberts. That was the pseudonym. Whoever was the boss that week was Mr. Roberts. And the Mr. Roberts at that time was a man named Joe Simon, who was much more experienced than Jack in comics, having been in the business for about 4 months longer. Joe was doing work on the outside, and he realized that this Jack Kurtzberg guy was a very prolific artist, eager to make money. And so Joe hired Jack to help him with some outside projects, and pretty soon they moved their entire partnership outside of Fox.
Joe, on his own, was a talented artist and writer. I think just over the years, people tend to think that because of the enormous output that Jack had and just how, you know, because of Marvel and everything, that somehow people think that Joe was the businessman and Jack was the creative end of it, and it really wasn't that one.
Simon and Kirby very quickly became the preeminent creative team in comics. And it wasn't a question of one writing and one drawing. If you asked Jack who did what, he'd say, we both did everything at different times. Now, that's not exactly true. Jack was more often the penciler because he was faster and more expert at that. Joe handled the business relationships. He was a very good editor. He was very good at talking to publishers.
Joe handled the business because Joe came from a different background than Jack did. Joe was from upstate New York. He'd gone to college. He had a better grasp of business than Jack did, because Jack never really had to get involved in business just because of his environment. I mean, it was always get the job, do the job, and don't worry about it.
The big Simon and Kirby success, of course, was Captain America. And when you have that on your resume, everything else looks a little pale by comparison. But Simon and Kirby became the guys who created new books. They were the people who could take almost anything and turn it into something. They went to DC Comics after they did Captain America, and they did a strip called Boy Commandos, which was one of the highest-selling comics of its day. They did the Newsboy Legion. They took an existing strip called Sandman and revamped it, and that became a hit. They took an existing strip and turned it into a thing called Manhunter, and that was a huge hit. Afterwards, they went off and they basically invented the love comic. They did a book called Young Romance, which sold millions of copies. They did a book called Black Magic. They did Bullseye. They did Fighting America. You just go on down this list. They could create a new book almost every week or so.
When he first started Captain America and the other strips he was working on in the 40s, he was really going for speed. You know, they just had to churn out a lot of work in a short amount of time. And so I think you don't see as much detail in that early work than, say, you know, doing some of the later work for Marvel. But it's kind of when he developed a style where, you know, literally the guy's foot's jumping off the page. But they were working pretty fast, so there wasn't a lot of time for detail.
Captain America was a very good-selling book, but it wasn't Superman, Batman, and Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. But he, even then, if you read the old in issues of Walter Ego and things like that, the comments of the older artists in the 1940s saying they would look at Jack Kirby's work and they couldn't believe what he was doing then. So I think his work influenced so many people even before the Marvel Age ever was dreamed of, you know, 20 years before the Marvel Age was dreamed of.
The time of Jack Kirby, there's what you'd have to call the ages of Jack Kirby. There's the early age where, you know, he's with all the old guys who began comics, and people were just cranking out page after page after page. Then there was the terrible time, 1953, when a guy named Frederick Wortham came down on comic books. Because he was a psychologist, and he told America that comic books were corrupting our children, and the Congress attacked them in a very similar way to the way America attacked communists, and comic books became no better than toilet paper.
I mean, if you think about it, it's pretty horrifying to think that here are all these people who had these jobs and careers in an industry that suddenly, before their eyes, is disappearing. They've just got to get out.
Jack Kirby stayed in, but he stayed in around the edges. He would go, he and his partner Joe Simon would go from company to company that survived, and they would create these little comic book companies. Then they would do three or four titles. They would appear, they would hire all the peripheral guys who had been kicked out, bring them back in for a while, turn out three or four issues of three or four comic book titles for Harvey comic books, for Archie comic books, and there was one other set of comic books where they did this group of comic books to try to bring back the more realistic comic books, and each time they failed.
They tried other things. They wrote scripts for television. I think he had a show that NBC was interested in. He tried newspaper strips. He tried, you know, he was willing to try anything, but I think comics were the one thing that he could really, as an artist, focus on and just get what he wanted to say out there.
I don't know if it happened right after that, soon after that, or immediately after that, or what, but Jack Kirby went back to his old stomping grounds, Timely Comics, and got together with Stan Lee and started to do comic books again. And that's the beginning of Marvel.
And he went to work for them drawing these bizarre monster comics. He drew everything. He drew these bizarre monster comics. He drew romance comics. He drew westerns. He drew war for very, very bad money.
All of these stories were done before. Not everyone exactly the same way, but essentially that was the theme of Stan's stories. Jack took those themes and turned those stories into feature-length movies or comic books and twisted these characters just enough to make them into heroes.
Definitely without Jack Kirby, there wouldn't be Marvel Comics. I mean, because I think everyone agrees, no matter how many different stories there are about what happened, most people agree that they were shutting the doors before the FF came out. I mean, the way Jack tells it, the way he told it to me was he went up there and they were taking the chairs out.
If you had said, can you go in and make a full range of superheroes out of what Timely had at that time, the answer would be no, that's not possible. But once they began, they could then step to the next one. So you had the Fantastic Four, then you had the Hulk, well, then you had Ant-Man, then you had Iron Man. Then, of course, there was Captain America, who was frozen in the ice, or we didn't know where he was. Well, let's go get him. And then there's Submariner. And then you can create new characters, and then let's go dig up some other characters, and let's do this and do that. And after a while, they have a comic book line, but and they have, in effect, the mirror of DC's comic book line.
You know, and the funny thing is, I think I would have been proud to have said, Jack and I did the Fantastic Four and let it go with that, but my gosh, at the same time, we were doing Thor, and we were doing the X-Men, and we were doing Sergeant Fury, and Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., and a lot of, and I don't even remember all the things. And Jack was equally good at every one of them, every one of them.
It's as though Jack Kirby's plan, which was to go in and see whatever is around and turn it into something, either stuff that's left over or make new stuff, it finally worked. He took what Stan was doing, and Stan, it's not like Stan was made to change. Stan was still doing his monster stories, except that these monsters turned into heroes. And it worked. Who would have predicted it? I can't even imagine.
Some people say that the initial plan was, okay, we'll revive Captain America and the Submariner and the Human Torch. Other people say Stan had a vision. Other people say Jack had a vision. It's a little difficult to sort through all these things. But at some point, Stan and Jack put together the first issue of the Fantastic Four. And it had certain elements in it of the strip Jack had just done for DC called The Challenges of the Unknown. It had certain elements of the 40s Timely comics. They brought back the Human Torch. But it had a lot in it that nobody had done in comics before. It was a very fresh, new kind of comic. And it caught on.
Somewhere along the line with the FF, Jack broke all the boundaries. You know, he just exploded. His imagination took off. What a vehicle the FF was for him, you know, and he created the FF, you know? And anybody who thinks otherwise doesn't understand Jack Kirby, because you think Stan Lee could have created the FF? No. Stan was the instigator, and frankly, if Jack had written it, it would have been a bust. Stan was a terrific scripter. They were a great combination, Lennon and McCartney, you know. But Jack was the mind behind everything. Jack was the John Lennon. Paul was the guy who made it smooth.
The two of them,
yeah, Stan sold
were perfect.
The
business. Oh yeah, the two were better than I've ever seen any team before.
Jack made the product, Stan sold the product.
Yeah.
He was the most imaginative, inventive guy I've ever met. I mean, his imagination was incredible, the things he thought of.
If you know Jack's work, you can see all that stuff coming out of Jack's mind. Black Panther, perfect for him. Jack has always been an advanced thinker. You know, people talk about me as being one of the first people to put a black character, a black superhero in the comics. Well, Black Panther came first. Hello, let's not forget.
Well, the thing that made Jack so special to me, A, he was so great to work with. He never missed a deadline. Whatever you needed, if I said to him, Jack, we're up, it's an emergency, I've got to have these 5 pages by tonight or tomorrow, I had them. He never did a job or a page that wasn't as good as his other pages. No matter how he had a rush, no matter what the conditions were, his quality was always up there. It never slacked off.
I think that there may be people who have the talent to do what Kirby has done. So I don't want to idolize him so much. But you know, it's Kirby and the world Kirby was in. Stanley said, Jack, do what you want. Jack said, well, you know, I'm going to do this. Fine. I'm going to do this. Fine. Whatever you want to do, Jack, you do that. That was Stan Lee's great gift.
I remember the first couple of issues of the FF, I was a little bit lukewarm too, because I didn't get it yet. And then
neither did they. It took them about 4 issues to figure out what they were doing.
But there was a splash page, I think it was in number 7. There was the splash page looking straight up at these buildings, and the Fantastic Four were all being floated up, I think, by Dr. Doom.
There's that great shot, one of the panels of the Submariner climbing the building towards you.
Yeah.
That's another space.
And you're going, oh my God, I've never seen anything like this. You know, I'm a huge Superman fan. He's my favorite character, but every single Superman story began as Superman returns from a mission in space, and then he gets involved with a story where Lois tries to figure out who he is. And I'm going, I want to see that space mission. Stan and Jack were the only ones who ever did that space mission that I really desperately wanted to see.
Jack worked on all the Marvel superhero books of the 60s to some extent. In some cases, it was advisory or suggesting villains or doing covers and sometimes designing the villains on the covers. But basically, he did this long run of Fantastic Four. He did the early issues of the X-Men and the Avengers. He did the first couple Thor stories, left the book, then came back and did an extended run on that. He did Captain America. He did the early Sergeant Fury and his Howling Commandos. He did a bunch of issues of Iron Man. He did the first couple Hulk stories, then came back to that character. He drew whatever they told him to. It's interesting, you know, he did 102 issues of Fantastic Four. If he'd gotten the financial terms that he wanted and the contract he wanted, he would have stayed at Marvel forever, and he would have drawn Fantastic Four as long as they wanted. He could have done 200 issues or 300 issues.
This dissatisfaction with the fact that Jack was so creative and so prolific and could carry a company on his back, and that there came a time when he felt like, I should be getting more, I should be given some kind of position, I should be given a vice presidency. And frankly, I can't blame him for that. That would have been something very nice. It just didn't seem to make sense to the company.
Jack left Marvel early in 1970. He had a dispute which most politely could be characterized as saying that he felt he had not received either the credit for the work he had done there or the money, some of the monies and rewards that had been promised him.
You know, my father was, he was a scrappy little guy. And, he didn't take well to getting pushed around, which I think was one of the big frustrations for him with Marvel, and that, you know, he didn't want to take things lying down, but on the other hand, you know, he had, a wife and 4 kids to feed.
So he went over to DC Comics, and he started a series there called The New Gods. He did Jimmy Olsen. He started a lot of new books of varying quality and success. He wasn't happy about it, but he didn't feel he had a choice.
He came by and said, you know, I'm going to DC. And Mark and I said, wow, that was like something. And he said, would you like to come and be assistants to help me do it? Because what he wanted to do was set up a West Coast operation. At that time, the only West Coast comic book company was Western, which was doing the animation stuff. Anybody who wanted to work in comic books for DC or Marvel, you had to live on the East Coast. Jack was the first guy they ever let out, so he could mail his stuff in. Because this was before, in the old days, before the internet, before faxes, before FedEx. Everything was the post office or the phone.
And for a couple of years, Steve and I assisted him by virtue of doing darn near nothing. Jack did not need assistance. If some of his plans had materialized, he would have, but if he was just going to sit there and write and draw New Gods, we were just there kind of to keep him company. And my main function was to say, hey, that sounds like a good idea, Jack.
He would show us what he had come up with and ask us what we thought. And he also wanted us to write and do things, because he had the idea, as soon as he went to DC, to do the two magazines, In the Days of the Mob and Spirit World. So we were going to help write stuff for that. And to come up with any ideas we had, because he was doing 4 books. He was doing Jimmy Olsen, New Gods, Forever People, Mr. Miracle.
I think that Jack expected something different at DC. He expected whatever he expected and whatever he was dissatisfied with at Marvel, he expected a new ball game. And I don't think that Jack got a new ball game. I think he got the same old ball game.
If in 1970, DC or Marvel had given Jack the exact same contract they gave newcomers in 1985, Jack would have been very happy. He would have gotten the credit and money he deserved. But in 1970, when he said, well, you know, I should have some sort of sales bonus in this thing, they told him, no, we can't do that. No, we can't share the copyright on this stuff. No, we can't pay you, we can't return your original art to you. We can't do all these things that later became very standard. Jack was told in the 60s and 70s, the business cannot do these, legally, morally, functionally. And one of the rewards Jack had was that he lived to see the comic book business change exactly the way he always knew it would have to change. And of course, the sad part was that he was not in a position to benefit directly from those changes.
I think that sometimes you can be too good and people consider it a threat. I mean, Jack was awfully good. You know, Jack really had no ambitions besides doing what he was doing. But sometimes people interpret it differently. I don't know.
Jack went back to Marvel in 1975. His relationship with DC had soured. He wasn't happy there. Marvel wanted him back. They were willing to treat him marginally better than DC at a time when that mattered. I don't think any company ever treated him commensurate with his worth or value to the company. But he went back to Marvel in 1975, unhappily, and did Captain America again. He did a book called The Eternals. He did The Black Panther. He did a book called 2001 based on the movie. He did a book called Machine Man that spun off of that. He did a very weird comic called Devil Dinosaur that was kind of created to be a Saturday morning cartoon show but never became one. And he wasn't happy there, and finally he just got out of comics pretty much. He got into animation.
When Kirby left Marvel, I'm much less of a fan of his DC work. The Marvel work was really the top of it all for me. But Kirby is also so unique in that, and I talked to other creators about this, he's the only person I know that in three decades was the top man in his field and reinvented himself each time. So the way he drew when he created Captain America was different than the way that he drew when he drew, when he sort of created the romance comics and monster comics in the 50s. And then the way that he drew at Marvel, creating the FF, and it just within a few years, if you look at from 61 to 65, it's totally different and better every time. And this is, you know, 30 years down the line. So for a guy to have that kind of intense creativity that long, that many pages into his career, is unprecedented.
You probably heard this from other people, actually, because it's always a surprise when you meet Jack Kirby. I met him in 68. He was still living in New York, on Long Island. And I was astonished that he wasn't 35 feet tall. That's the biggest thing, you know? I saw this. I mean, I knew what he looked like because he'd done a cartoon of himself, you know, for that some Marvel thing, you know? And he always had a cigar. Classic stuff, you know? He was James Cagney, basically.
He was about 5'6". He sort of reminded me a little bit of a cross between sort of Jimmy Cagney, sort of George Burns.
In my youthful mind, I saw him as a cross between Galactus and Reed Richards with some Ben Grimm in his voice, in his locution. But anyway, he was the sweetest guy you could ever meet. You know, he was the star of comics, hands down.
He had a wonderful way with people. Jack was the kind of person who, it didn't matter who you were, he treated everyone the same. If you were a 13-year-old kid came up to him and showed him your drawing, he would look at it and say, hey, that's really nice, that's good. You know, you should do this, but keep at it and this. If you were a celebrity that came up to you, he was the same way. He was like, hi, how you doing? Oh. And he would say, well, so what do you do? And he'd start, you know, he was really interested in people.
You know, because my father was just such a, he was such a humble person that, you know, he just never had any kind of, you know, ego about him whatsoever.
You have to remember that prior to, let's say, 1970, he pretty much worked in anonymity. I mean, back in Long Island, he worked in what he called the cave, which was the basement of their home in East Williston. And that's where he was. He would draw the books, take him once a week, he'd go into the city.
And during that period at Marvel, in terms of looking at it a standpoint of home life, at that point, he was doing so many books and churning out so much work. He was working, oh, I don't know how many years, 12, 14 hours a day, a lot of weekends. We lost a lot of weekends. And from a standpoint of being a kid, again, I never thought much about it. It was, it was his job. And of course, he was working at home. So, if I ever needed anything, I could just go downstairs and see him and watch TV with him.
Jack drew most of the early Marvel superhero things in a little airless room at his house in New York, which he called the dungeon.
Back east, all the houses have basements. And this particular studio, I remember because it was just called the dungeon because it was just tiny and cramped and full of his stuff piled up, and there was like no light. And that's where he worked. It was quiet. He didn't really care about his surroundings that much.
It was described to me as having a wall full of science fiction paperbacks, which he would occasionally reach behind himself and pick one up, riff through it to get an idea. He'd pull a phrase out of it, and that would generate an entire new concept somehow.
I would go in there, and the TV would be on, a radio would be on. Sometimes I'd go in there, and he'd have the Spanish station on. He doesn't know any Spanish, but he just liked the sound or the music or just any kind of background, that would help him, I guess, as far as his work or just keep him occupied.
When they lived in East Williston and he worked in the basement, occasionally fans would come and see him, but there really wasn't a place where people would go and you could meet the guys that drew the comics.
13, yeah, we came 14. Over for milk and cookies on Saturdays.
Yeah.
We would just drive over.
His Roz would force us to have something to eat because...
Yeah, you couldn't go to a Jewish house without having a sandwich.
Exactly. So we'd have a sandwich first, then we'd go downstairs to his office, and he'd be drawing away, and he'd be talking to us the whole time. It was just incredible. And nothing ever stopped him from drawing the whole time he was talking.
Yeah, hand was always moving, producing.
Jack had this old, old drawing board that he had hauled across the country. When he moved from New York to Los Angeles, it was the last thing they put on the van and the first thing they took off in Southern California because he had to go back to work. And it was this beat up, I had a better drawing table when I was 12 years old than Jack Kirby had most of his life.
It was beaten up and battered. It was, fairly standard drawing table, ink all over it, smudged from graphite.
He sat in this rigid back wooden dining room chair from a dinette set that the family no longer owned.
It was the most uncomfortable thing you'd ever want to sit in.
They'd thrown out everything except the one chair that Jack liked.
He would sit in that chair just kind of like this, just like that. He's right-handed. And he would just, cigar here when he smoked. And he'd just start, just go through the night like that.
He used plain old-fashioned pencils, plain old-fashioned paper, an old beat-up ruler. Somehow it just, happened.
I remember when we first moved, it was basically for health reasons, because my mother was an asthmatic, and she wasn't always a real well woman, and then I was always sick all the time as well.
A doctor just said it was, either Arizona or California, is where she needed to go. And they had some cousins out here, so they initially moved to Irvine, to the only housing, I think, that was built in Irvine at the time. And that was in 68. They lived in Irvine for a year or two, but of course they didn't have any relatives or friends there. My mother had some cousins up in Thousand Oaks, so they found a nice little piece of land there and built a home up in Thousand Oaks, moved up there in 1970.
I met Jack in July of 1969, a couple weeks after I got out of high school. We had a comic book club in L.A. I was the president of it, and our officers went down and met him. And we sat there all day with our jaws open, listening to Jack discourse on comics and comic history. And right in the middle of the day, the phone rang, and it was Stan Lee calling to discuss the next issue of Fantastic Four, and my friends and I just kind of sat there tingling. We were witnessing the magic happening firsthand. And he was this wonderful, gracious host who had answered all our questions and showed us all this artwork he was doing. It was the first time I'd seen uninked Jack Kirby artwork. And my friends and I were just babbling idiots, pretty much the way I'm babbling right now, or we were babbling back then, we couldn't believe what we were looking at.
To me, Jack, I don't think he even knew who he was talking to sometimes. We were all kind of one lump thing of his admirers. And he never treated us like a number or anything like that. We were all important to him. But we were just faces and people that would come in and out of his house to tell him our own personal stories about why we would want to make a trek to his house in the first place, why Jack Kirby was so important to us. And that's the way he took it, just as an offering of gratitude and thanks to everyone that would show up at his doorstep.
We had these people, and people would just show up sometimes. I mean, their phone number was listed, and people knew where they lived. And they were some kind of UFO cult. And my father, they just wanted to take my father with them and beam him up to wherever it is they were. And he just let them in and showed them around. My mom made them lunch, and that's how it was at my house. They were just so open to everyone. You know, no one was ever discouraged at all. It was just an open door policy. So they were just real humble people and very caring. My mother was always feeding everybody. You know, typical Jewish mother, I guess.
The whole family was fun. Jack was great, Roz was great, Neil, Lisa, Barbara. I mean, it was just fun to be there because they were a great family. And they just invited everybody in, who no matter who showed up, it was like, okay, come on in, let's have a barbecue, let's go swimming. They were like a second family almost to a lot of people, I think, who would show up there, especially to people who were just starting out in comics who needed, you know, some guidance or something. Jack would like say, okay, you know, let me take a look at what you have.
Lynn and I, when we were kids, went to Jack's house and we watched him draw. I think it was in the Galactus storyline.
One of them. He watched with effort. The most astonishing natural artist I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
He projected it from his head.
It was all there.
Yeah.
It was the whole page was there.
There was I always tell this story because it just to this day blows my mind. There's a famous issue of Tales of Suspense, a splash page for a Captain America story, which is Steve Rogers in an airport. He's not in costume. He's standing there with his portfolio that the shield is hidden in. And there are people walking in front of him in several layers, people walking past him and behind. He's waiting for someone to pick him up. Behind that, there's this huge panoramic window where you see planes taking off and coming in. Watch Jack draw that. He didn't lay anything out. He started drawing in the upper left-hand corner and drew that page to the bottom right.
We've seen him do...
I've never seen anything like that in my life.
We saw him do a hand in one place. Just the hand. No rough sketching. No little blue pencil.
Yeah,
no rough...
Ask us. Every time we came over, he would do sketches for us. Who do you want this time? Captain America. Okay, cool. And he'd put a fist.
And a foot here. And maybe a belt. Maybe, you know, something. And it would connect.
It would just connect.
It was
fit when he was done.
He wouldn't, like a lot of artists, plan out the whole thing and figure out his perspective. And at the end, he would spend some time balancing his darks, his dark areas, his black areas, and tweaking little parts of the drawing. But the basic construction of the drawing just came out of nowhere.
He would just start drawing. It would be like somebody who, writing a novel, immediately went to a final draft without doing a rough draft. He'd always start, I asked him once, as a matter of fact, and he told me he always started in the middle of the story. He'd think of the middle of the story first, and then create a beginning, and then go and create an end.
You know, I say this all the time, you know, writing a comic book is very much like writing a song. You have to understand all of the instruments that are going to play, when they're going to play, whether or not they're going to be loud or they're not going to be loud. You need to build a rhythm through the story, and that's why the best stories, and something, again, that Kirby just had a gift for, he knew when to make the image small, and he knew when to make the image big, and when to use a spread, and when to use splash, and all the elements that were given, you just have to know what would make the best way of telling that story.
And don't forget that at the same time while he's doing that, he's got another book he's got to do the following week. So if he was sitting there drawing the Fantastic Four, by the time he got to the last panel in the Fantastic Four page and shipped that off, he had to start the Thor panel one, a whole new story with all different characters, which is why he would get confused. They would have to send him the comic books. They would have to send him Xeroxes of the artwork before it was printed just so he could remember where he was.
More often than not in comics, in, improperly done, whether it's in comics or it's in computer games or whatever, what you have is people who take ideas that are already there and reinvent them or pretend to reinvent them. As often as not, they destroy the idea that went before and they say, I can do it better, which is not a good way to do it. The idea person says, I have a new idea. And that's what Jack does.
Jack Kirby was one of the most unique artists in the history of art, not just in comic books. And everything Kirby touched was unique. And his imagination spanned so many characters, so many concepts, that they are the types of characters and concepts that keep speaking to new generations. They're not locked into a certain time, although they are of their time. Like things that are universal, Kirby's work, he was a storyteller as well as just an artist. So Kirby's stories, his characters, his visual concepts were both of their time and timeless as well. And you can only find that in very few creators in any field whose work stands the test of time, yet was of its time as well.
He got very excited when he was drawing. He put a lot of himself and a lot of his emotion into the drawing. And a lot of what he was trying to do, I believe, was to create that same kind of emotion in the reader. And that meant stretching anatomy, stretching perspective, sometimes inventing brand new rules of depth perception right in front of your very eyes.
I mean, I don't think Jack really could draw anatomy. I don't think Jack could draw a real car, you know? I don't think he that wasn't Jack. He was a visceral animal and drew impressions of things.
It almost looks like happy accidents, you know? It's like he's drawing so fast that, you know, the drawing just kind of comes out a certain way. If you really look at Jack's anatomy, it doesn't make any sense. You know, the people look like, they look like, you know, robots or toys or something, because the anatomy is just, it's almost like mechanical rather than living flesh. And it's almost, it has like this weird abstract stylization on it.
If you'd sit around with artists and you talk about Jack's anatomy, you go, it would be like, you'd get the artist that would be critical, you know, and say, oh, he doesn't know how to do anatomy. And then you'd say, but can you do the power that he can do? Can you do it? Let's just say I ask you to do it. Would you know what to do? Because wouldn't you be essentially held back by what you know and then have to do that? And then guys would say, and they knew it because they'd examined the work.
Well, Jack drew his figures in time. The fist in the foreground is in a different time zone as the foot in the back. And I think he's the only artist I've ever observed who was able to do that. Someone who might just totally blank out the power of his work might look at something and say, that's a little out of drawing. But that wasn't the case. I mean, Jack, in the beginning, academically knew how to draw the human figure. As he evolved as an artist, he became an impressionist. Then I think he became an expressionist.
He'd had this way of like doing these rounded muscles. Then he'd do this straight line through the muscle that represented sinew. But sinew is something that's very subtle. It has slight curves and it goes like that. Jack would do this straight line and do another a couple of straight lines. And in your mind, you go, I know what that is. That's sinew. This is muscle. This is sinew. But it's just a black line. But Jack had this shorthand method of knocking it out. And if you were to say, well, what is that? You know, he has no right to do that. And you go, well, excuse me, I can go to the museums any day and I can say this, I can see the same kind of interpretation done by people whose paintings are selling for hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars. And you're telling me Jack Kirby can't do it? Wrong.
You know, I argue with people. I say, well, listen, this, you know, you're looking at Kirby. Kirby is on a par with Goya when Goya's doing his cartooning. And of course, you know, nobody wants to believe that because Goya's, you know, great artist and Kirby does comic books and comic books are not, you know. But when the first picture of the Mole Man is unbelievable. It's so beautiful.
So me as an artist, it just overwhelms me to see that gutsy, ballsy thing and in a way say to myself, I can't do it. I cannot. I would like to be able to, I mean, I can't do it, but maybe I'd corrupt myself if I did it. Ooh,
That's danger. You go, oh, I like to ink it though. Like do that slashing line.
I mean, all his drawing is just, it's like every human movement is exaggerated. I mean, if somebody was sitting in a chair, it would look like they were moving and they were sitting in the chair at the same time. He didn't like things being still.
A lot of us guys growing up reading Jack Kirby's comic books were so taken by his work that we decided that we wanted to become or try to become professional artists like Jack Kirby. And it's at that time when you go back and deliberately study and dissect that you understand the gift this guy had for composition. Here's a perfect example right here in this Claw comic right here. I'll give you an example of cool composition right here. This scene down here, the way Claw is poised there, that's about as extreme a pose as you can ever get. And this is an extreme pose that us kids reading these would always pick up on when looking at a Kirby comic. We just had to register it in an emotional way without ever knowing the tricks and rules that go into a formal composition or a dynamic composition. It was just there.
I think he was special because he really defined the vocabulary of superhero comics. I mean, before superhero comics really became the predominant genre within publishing, you know, there's romance comics and westerns and horror, and, you know, they're all very successful. Now it's just superheroes. And part of that success, I think, is from what Jack Kirby created, which was the vocabulary. This is how people fly. This is how people smash through brick walls. And this is how you create this kind of godlike power in these figures. You put the legs apart, if you really want to analyze it, you put the legs apart like this, the hips like this, fist, you know, foreshortening, all that kind of stuff. The Kirby crackle, I mean, he invented all this stuff that people just used years, decades afterwards, and we're still building on the sort of core vocabulary that he created, this core code that he created.
One of the things I think people didn't understand is that Jack Kirby was a two-person operation. It was Jack and Roz.
Everybody that loved Jack loved Roz, and you couldn't help but do it because, you know, she was there to make sure he was able to entertain us.
Basically, my mother ran the roost.
Yeah, she ran the show. She told all the kids what to do. She laid my father's clothes out, you know, because he would probably be mismatched, and he just didn't care about those things. You know, everyday things just were not that important to him.
If my father had cash in his wallet, it's because she put it there. I mean, she did everything. I mean, my father, in a lot of ways, was a very typical eccentric creative artist, and that, you know, didn't care what he wore, couldn't screw in a light bulb. That was a family joke. And just in essence, my mother pretty much, she just, you know, ran everything, and my father just kind of did his thing and went along with the flow.
You know, in his younger days, when he worked in a studio with Joe Simon or the other artists, that was one thing. When he finally went to work for Marvel in the late 50s, early 60s, and he worked at home, it got to the point where he was so engrossed in creating the stories and the artwork that he had to give up driving because he couldn't drive anymore. Neil would tell me stories of where he would get in the car with Jack and they'd start driving and they'd just end up on the curb or on the sidewalk because Jack would be just thinking about the next story.
I was waiting and I don't know what he was thinking, but there was a telephone pole here and the side of a candy store here, and he went up on the sidewalk between them to pick me up. So, yeah. So eventually, by the time we came out to California, that was it for Dad's driving.
So she had a drive for him and just took care of the everyday things of life just so he can do what he did.
Roz was the most wonderful thing that could have happened to Jack. I could not have imagined Jack functioning without her. She was a very strong-willed woman. She cared about his work passionately. She went with him everywhere.
I guess you would call her a pistol. She was so full of energy and life. Just a conversation with Roz, you would laugh, and then you would hear her, you know, she was so feisty. I could not believe the woman was the age she was. And to hear her talk about her husband and all her husband went through, she was obviously his defender and his protector. You know, if you would bring up the name of someone who had slighted Jack in some way, man, I mean, you know, I don't mean to be mean, but the fangs came out. I mean, she would say, oh, that person, you know, they really shouldn't have done that.
She's so patient with him. She puts up with him. I mean, he was such a pain in the ass, clearly a pain in the ass. And she just smiles benignly, and she makes his world right.
I think she was just one hell of a great lady. This is a woman who could invite into her home, usually without prior notice, a couple of dozen fans, make sandwiches for them, mother them all day long. I mean, she was just phenomenal.
I don't think he would have made most of the decisions he made. And I'm not saying those, not the desperate decisions where you have to get work, but making these critical decisions to work on Sky Masters and to do these other things without her. And she never pushed herself forward as the person who did that. But you would see, you can tell when a man turns to a woman and checks her out, and it's benign, you know, she's just, no, it's fine, you know. She lets it go. It's fine. That silent communication speaks volumes.
And she answered the phone. There were times when Jack would, if he answered the phone, somebody would talk him into the worst business deal or the worst promise to do something for free. And Roz would answer the phone and say, no. We'd go to conventions, and Jack would be there. And Jack did not like doing sketches at conventions because they were just sold, and he felt exploited by them. But he also didn't like saying no to people. So Roz would say no to them. And she'd stand by him, and kids would come up and say, Mr. Kirby, will you draw me a thing? And she'd stop him. And if Jack said no, it was because he knew that Roz would get upset. And sometimes, like, she'd have to go to the ladies' room, and she'd turn to me, and she'd say, hey, Mark, stand over here and say no until I get back.
I saw some art he had done. There were some Thor page, pencil pages. I said, Jack, these are great. And he goes, you like them? And we're looking at him. He goes, take them. I'm like, what do you mean take them? And he says, you can have them. This is how Jack was. And I said, can I take two of them? It's, you know, rude of me, but he said, sure, take two. So I take two of them. And I just couldn't believe he was handing out this artwork, and I couldn't wait to get it home. And anyway, we get to the door, and Roz says, whoa, 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 where are you going with that? You know, and I said, Jack gave it to me. And she goes, no, Jack didn't give that to you. It goes through me. So obviously I had to hand the pages back, but I ended up buying them a few months later.
She protected him from being exploited, not as well as, you know, we might have liked, because Jack was exploited an awful lot in his life. But she managed to keep him at the drawing board every day and to get rid of all the problems that stopped him from getting to the board and creating the work.
Comic artist's wife has to be a very special person. I could not have survived without Virginia. I don't think Jack would have survived without Roz.
Roz had this knack of, yes, she took care of Jack. But I don't even know if she ever really consciously thought about it. It was just, they were, in my opinion, this incredibly perfect couple. And sometimes I feel that way about myself and my spouse, where you finish each other's sentences. And they were just this perfect unit, and it worked well. And I don't think that, you know, that I don't want to hear some feminist say that she had this secondary role. Bullshit. It was Jack and Roz.
After Jack passed away, Roz had her moment in the spotlight. And in looking for the silver lining in it, there was a nice thing there where she did get that moment, because she was very, very important in his life. And she went to the conventions, and she was applauded on her own. She got the standing ovation on her own, not as an adjunct to the, you know, the guy with the pencil.
Because I think what she felt too is she was a little worried that when Dad passed, that's, you know, she might be forgotten and people wouldn't, you know, it was because of Dad they came around. And it wasn't like that at all. And, you know, I really appreciate the support that she did get.
At the conventions, she would get the same standing ovations he always got. And, you know, people would flock. Yeah, I loved it. You know, with our little booth at the San Diego Comic-Con, when Roz would come over, we'd go from a little gathering around our booth, all of a sudden this big throng of people would be around. And it was so great because they all just wanted to come up and shake her hand and just say how much they admired her husband and her.
And I think she always thought of herself, oh, I'm kind of just the woman behind the man. But people really didn't think of her. Like, they called him Jack King Kirby. Well, she was the queen, so. But it, the outpouring was just, and the support, and, you know, I can't tell people enough. You know, when she did go to the conventions, she did get a lot of attention and, you know, made sure that she was still welcome and loved. And we still had family, friends, and artists that would come by the house and see her from time to time. I know Mike Richardson from Dark Horse came and took time out of his schedule, came to Thousand Oaks, took her out to dinner. And people just kind of went out of their way to make sure that she knew that, you know, she was not going to be forgotten.
You know, I think it's amazing, and I think it's just such a great tribute to my father that even here we are how many years after his death, and we have all these people still, you know, involved in his life and his artwork.
I do not want my father to be forgotten. And, you know, he was just, he helped create this industry. He put people, you know, Marvel where they are today.
Kirby really did. It was really the apex. I mean, really, the golden age of comics is really the Marvel age of comics.
He really made the industry what it is today. He was a far thinker. He used to say things at lunch, like he was the first guy I ever heard say, you will see the day when we will have comic art in museums. And of course we laughed, you know. And within his lifetime it happened. I never envisioned that kind of stuff. I thought comic pages were always going to be considered the trash, throwaway article of the magazine field, and I never thought of elevated grandeur that Jack did. Jack said, we're doing some great stuff here. People notice it, and they're going to notice it even more. Very far thinker.
You can't forget him because he had such a powerful presence.
When you were around Jack, you felt like a better writer or a better artist. It may have been illusory in some of us, but the same way Jack would draw these people who radiated energy in his comics, he radiated a certain energy, it was creative energy.
Because he took his abstract thoughts, and I'm using the word correctly, that is an abstract thought, turning it into energy, and he transferred it to paper.
He just really knew his art. And he wasn't stuck. I mean, he was creating. He was always creating the world of the comic book, rather than fitting into something that was already created.
I think he was a watershed artist for comics, in that there's a lot of art in comics over the years, and there are very few guys, I think Jack is one of them, maybe Jack is the only one, there's, from his work in the 60s especially, and he was quite good back in the 40s and 50s too, but in the 60s, once he remade the language of superhero comics, he remade it visually. And so what you have is you have artists who are pre-Kirby, and you have artists who are post-Kirby.